and just worship Him tonight. Spirit of the Sovereign Lord, come and make Your presence known, reveal the glory of the risen King. Hallelujah. Oh, Spirit of the Sovereign Lord, come and make Your presence known, reveal the glory of the risen King. Oh, let the weight of Your glory cover us. Let the light of Your river flow. Let the truth of Thy kingdom reign in us. Let the weight of Your glory, let the weight of Your glory fall. We do not seek Your hand, we seek Your face. We do not seek Your hand, we only seek Your face. We only seek Your face. Oh my Lord, we want to see You. We want to know You. Reveal Your glory in this place. Open up your mouth and tell Him, let the weight of Your glory, let the weight of Your glory cover us. Let the light of Your river flow. Let the truth of Your kingdom reign in us. Let the weight of Your glory, let the weight of Your glory fall. One more time. Let the weight of Your glory, let the weight of Your glory cover us. Let the light of Your river flow. Let the truth of Your kingdom reign in us. Let the weight of Your glory, let the weight of Your glory fall. Hallelujah. Father, we thank You. We bless Your name today. There is nobody like You. We love You. That's why we came. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank You for tonight. We ask that You do us good as unto Zion. Make Thyself known unto Your people. Throw Your weight around. Make Yourself available, as it were in the days of old, that Your presence will overshadow and do an overcast over this broadcast tonight. In the name of Jesus, we thank You for another level, for a new dimension. We thank You for what You've provided and what You've done. Thank You because You will tie it together. Thank You because of excellence. Thank You for the Spirit of grace. Thank You for Your mercy. Thank You for Your glory. Thank You, Father, for the reach of this ministry. In the name of Jesus, we ask that the blessing of God will be where you are now as you're praying. I want you to open up your mouth if you can and tell the Lord, I came for an encounter throughout this week. In the name of Jesus, despite and in spite of myself, I have come to Mount Zion, the city of our God. I have come to the presence of God. I have come to the innumerable company of angels. I want to meet You. Put your demand out there for a few minutes. In the name of Jesus, for 2 minutes or so, open up your mouth and tell the Lord, even as there's a music play, I came for fire. I came to encounter grace. I came to encounter the power of God. I came to encounter visitation. I will not come out of this mountain with no exception at all. Each and every one of you tonight will have an encounter. Open up your mouth. Holy Spirit, We wait on you, Holy Spirit. We wait on you, Holy Spirit. We wait on you for fire, for fire, for fire, for fire. Oh, holy fire, burn upon my altar. From within me, Spirit, you take over. Holy fire, burn upon my altar. We thank you, Father. We bless your name. Do us good tonight, in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen and amen and amen. Well, we glorify God. Amen and amen and amen and amen. Welcome everybody tonight. Welcome, welcome to WINEPRESS. We are getting ready to bring you the word of the Lord. I want you to get your notebook, get your pen, get your paper, whatever it is that you can't be able to write on, in the name of Jesus. The presence of God is here, and He's getting ready to do you good tonight, in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen and amen. We thank you, Father. We bless your name. Amen. Genesis chapter 12. Genesis chapter 12. Genesis chapter 12. Verse 8 is where I'm going to begin tonight. Genesis chapter 8 from verse 12 is where I'm going to begin tonight, as we see where the Lord will make us stop, and then we'll pray. We're not going to take too long, because it is our first night. We're going to come back tomorrow night, and throughout the week up until Friday. We're not going to be meeting on Saturday, and because it's a conference, I like you to be available. And tell the people there is fire on the mountain, so they can be able to come up here, and especially those that are connected to friends that will keep on going to that other page, the personal page. You will do good if you tell them that we are not there, and if you can, if you have a friend, you can tag them, whatever it is that they could be lost in translation, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Genesis 12 and 8. And the Lord appeared unto Abraham, or Abram, by that time he was not Abraham, and said, unto thy seed will I give this land. And there builded he an altar unto the Lord, who appeared unto him. Well, and the Lord appeared unto Abraham, and said, unto thy seed will I give this land. There builded he an altar unto the Lord, who appeared unto him. The story, I'm going to get into my main scripture, Genesis 28 and verse 16 to 17. We'll get there in a moment. But just to put an introduction as to what it is that we are dealing with. We are going to deal with in this conference priesthood intelligence, the gateway to prosecuting destiny. And we're gonna be checking out individuals, but specifically Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and many other individuals that by virtue of their priesthood. And for those of you who've been in this ministry for a while, that is a word that keeps on coming up. Priesthood, in its proper definition, is all that God has made, you would say, the saint to be, in terms of executing the mandate of the kingdom of God on the earth. That will include prayer, that will include influence, that will include study of the word, if you may, that will include all hierarchies of spiritual expression that can be made, expressed experientially in the earth. In other words, God did not call us to be a bunch of Christians hidden up in church, or hidden in the pavement of the house, praying unto God, and just separated from wild events, politics, and every other thing. No, priesthood by its proper definition is that in the secret place you are talking to God, as in Daniel, and in the outward manifestation you can run governments, you can prosecute the righteousness and conform governments and peoples and powers and territories, and demonic entities will be made subject to the God that you carry. In other words, Peter said it this way, that we've been called a holy people, a holy nation rather, a peculiar people, that we may offer sacrifices unto God. But while we are yet offering sacrifices unto God, we are not doing that from the private place of a church and separated from world events or the platforms that make do of what it is life is. Because the believer, the average believer now, and even world over, have separated themselves from the dealings of what it is happening in the marketplace, in the world of politics, in the seven mountains, if you may. And we are just separated, segregated. We have no influence whatsoever. What priesthood does is that part of it is what we are going to deal with. Prayer begins now to prepare the individual, the believer, to be able to have dominion over the cosmos, over the world, over the earth. The scripture declared in Psalm 115 that he has given, the heaven of the heavens belong to God, but he has given the earth to the sons of men. That includes you and I. And that is the reason why we begin now our Bible study to deal as to what it is to prosecute destiny by use of priesthood. Priesthood intelligence, it demands and it meets the threshold for you to begin to influence the world. It's not just by prayer. It ain't just by fasting. Because prayer and fasting will deal with the demonic entities that subject people to it, to their own culture. The kingdom of God has a dimension and has a many dynamics to it as to how you need to prosecute the will of God, because every other entity in the face of the earth has a will. Every other entity in the face of the earth has a will, and it will take forceful priesthood or intelligence by priesthood to subject every other will that does not conform to the image, to the pattern, to the governance, and to the, you'd say, the will of God on the earth. It will take forceful priesthood, not just priesthood. And you will notice from the family of Abraham and from the life of Abraham, he in himself, he begins now to convocate in different places when he is sojourning. God begins to call him out in Genesis, and when he gets to Genesis 12, God begins to talk to Abraham, and he is sojourning, heading towards destiny. Remember, this is a man that God said, get out of your father's house, your kindred, get off from every place that you know to, and get out to the land, set out to a journey that I will show you. From then on, there was no Google, there was no GPS, there was no any other command that God gave to Abraham until he began living. It is in his living and in his obedience to God that God now begins to fashion his mind in frequency of visit with God. God begins to speak to him, and frequently the man that was Abraham begins to be transformed by the presence of God and by covenant, and eventually he becomes Abraham. But one of the things that we're going to deal with tonight is the heritage of priesthood that his son Isaac and Jacob came about to inherit. And I'd like you to pay attention unto verse 7 of Genesis 12 and 8. And the Lord appeared unto Abraham and said unto thy seed, he's giving him a promise now, I will give this land. And there he built an altar unto the Lord. My question to you would be, how did Abraham get to know to build an altar unto God? Where did he get the formula? Where did he get the, you'd say, the heritage? Something must have happened between Noah and the lineage of where Abraham's house was when he came to be, that he kind of inherited a heritage of building altars. I have preached a message and taught on dealing in the high place. You can find it on YouTube. And how it is that God has put into the hearts of many people from generation, especially from Abraham, all the way to the nation of Israel. And somehow, naturally so, because of heritage, they began to know how to build groves, high places of worship, to worship Jehovah. But eventually, when they fall out of place, they begin to worship the place instead of the God of the place. And so I'd like you to know that by the time you're reading Genesis 12, there is an entire long range of heritage of Noah, especially from Noah, of men that began to call upon the name of the Lord, and they were lifting up or building up altars. Now, what you know as altar today is not what it was before. An altar really was a physical place where men would go, or a man would go and have an experience. Maybe a tragedy happened, maybe a visitation happened in the case of Abraham, maybe a baby was born after a long time, maybe a tragedy happened and people begin to feel somehow they need to appease a God, in this case the God of the Hebrews, and they will lift up an altar and call upon the name of God. That one they got from the patriarch Abraham. Now, I can go on and on in many directions as it regards altars and high places, but that is not my attention tonight. I'd like you to pay attention to something here. And the Lord appears to Abraham and said unto him, thy seed I will give this land. And out of nowhere, Abraham gets almost like an astronomical vision that in the case of what God is promising, on the premise, on the value system of his word, because I've walked with him now and I'm headed towards the destiny of Canaan. But he is putting Abraham in the sphere of every land that the children of Israel would have to get. And just sojourning throughout, he gets to this place. This place now is called Bethel. And Abraham, the patriarch, after the encounter he has with God, the Lord appearing unto Abraham, said unto thy seed, I will give this land. And then there he builds an altar unto the Lord who appeared unto him. He builds an altar in the name of the God that has appeared unto him. I'll repeat that again. He built an altar to the God, or unto the Lord that has appeared unto him. So my question would be, what is it that you are building around? What is it that you've made the focus? What is it that has become, so to say, a treasure hunt? And that after you've gotten it, you've built an altar around it, because that has become your God. Now we can throw this into the wind and say, well, they have been praying, a lady has been praying for marriage, for marriage, for marriage, for marriage. And then God came into the scene in 2020 and answered our prayer and got this hunk, got this money, a man that has been blessed by God. Now they have a family, and now they have maybe two kids, or now they have three cars, or built a house and everything. And then suddenly, instead of building an altar unto the Lord, pay attention, they begin to build an altar around their marriage. So it is my husband, my children, my house. We are busy. We can't call up for the conference. We are busy. Husband is going abroad or making this deal. And you find the people who are in the prayer closet before, and people who are givers before, and people who are committed into the service of the Lord before, people who are giving before, people who are into priesthood. They would wake up at night or at 4 a.m. and they were committed unto God. Suddenly, the God of the place has been kicked out and the place has become a God. So we need to be careful how to build an altar, and we'll deal with this throughout the week. Bethel becomes the place of encounter. But Abraham is sure and careful enough to get to know that what it is that he needs to build is to build an altar unto God, not unto the place of encounter. No, he built the place of encounter. At the place of encounter, Bethel, he built an altar there. He didn't worship Bethel. He worshipped at Bethel. He worshipped at Bethel. Now watch carefully. And the Lord now appears unto Abraham, said unto Abraham, unto thy seed by promise now, I give this land. By that time, Abraham and Sarah are never close to anything that is called a seed. In other words, a baby. Verse 8. And then now, here comes the crust of the meat. And then we get to the next character, who is now Jacob. And he removed from thence, King James Version, he removed from that place. He went to the mountain on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent. This is Abraham the patriarch. Having Bethel on the west and Hai on the east, in between, betwixt the place where he is going to encounter, he has encountered God, and the place of promise, he is going towards Hai, and he has encountered God in Bethel. Verse 8 of Genesis 12. And he pitched his tent in the middle of those two cities or two places. There is something about being betwixt places, as King James Version would say. Jesus sent his disciples and he says, go into the city that is across to you. You will find a donkey or a cart or a mule, if you may, that has been tied betwixt places. Has no options whatsoever. Can't go back to the master. Can't go forward into the future. I'd like you to know that by any reason, if you are in betwixt places, fixed in between future, present, and a past, you are on the crossroads. You are neither in destiny, but you've just had an encounter in Bethel. Betwixt places. He removed thence unto a mountain, and then he gets into the east of Bethel, and he pitched his tent there, having Bethel on the west and Hai on the east. And there he builded an altar, this is the second time, unto the Lord, and called upon the name of the Lord. Notice, Abraham knows from heritage that his great-great-great-grandfathers were people of prayer, were people of priesthood. They were builders of altars unto the God. And they will fashion the God of the place based on how he appeared unto them and dealt with what it is that he needed to deal with. And to Abraham, notice how God is speaking and addressing the promise. He says unto Abraham, that unto thy seed I will give this land. And then he builds an altar unto the Lord there. Okay? When he builds the place of that first encounter, he comes again and he pitches his tent. Notice, Abraham is a migrant. He's moving from one place to another, seeking the city which is built by God, according to Hebrews 11. And in that context, he is not permanently residing in Bethel. He is not permanently residing in one place. He is seeking to fulfill the promise or the obedience of what it is God called him unto. He said, get out to the land I will show you. It's very dangerous to stay in the place where God meant for a transition. Pay attention. It is important for you to know when the cloud is moving, you move with the cloud. It's important for you to know when it has stopped, you stop. But many, including the children of Israel, as for an example, dwelt in the place of the mountain for far too long. They dwelt there, and God had to come through Moses and tell them, you have dwelt in this mountain for far too long. Put yourself together. Gather the people, for tomorrow about this time, you are getting ready to break camp and move to the next dimension. And so there are people who are in transition, but they don't know they are on transition. They are sticking it up there because it's either comfortable, either it is raining, either the grass has turned green, either there are provisions. And it is important for you to know that when it comes to transition, you've got to be sensitive and get connected to the same God that appeared unto you up until where you have transitioned to. He removed from thence. He didn't stay. The Lord had appeared in Bethel, but he didn't permanently stay there. It's important for the body and for the people of God to know that an encounter today does not necessarily mean that you will move in the strength of that encounter tomorrow. It could be that God is putting an encounter for you today to activate your movement or to build your faith, and then after to bring different encounters that will build you up so that you can activate destiny. And so priesthood becomes very intelligent, and that is the point I was coming into. It depends and it demands that people in the kingdom of God have to be very, very strict or conform to the discipline of spiritual intelligence. Because it is one thing to pray for a husband, as I've given you an example for ladies out there. You've been praying for 2 years, 3 years, then the husband came. And now you've gotten into a place where now the place has become a god instead of the God of the place. You begin to become busy. You begin to become, you would say, quiet, and you no longer pray the way you used to pray. You're not on fire the way you're supposed to be on fire. And everything about you now has become far removed from what it is that you are seeking God for. And then now the encounter is no longer there. You're worshiping the place, marriage, the place, work, the place, breakthrough, the place, business, the place, you know, jumping from one plane to another, going for businesses, going for conferences. And you can't be able now to spend the time with the God of the place. Very important. Bethel becomes the place of encounter. But verse 8 tells you clearly, Abraham did not dwell with one encounter. By intelligence, he knew the God of Bethel. He's not the God of all. His Bethel does not define him properly. It is not the end. It is only the beginning. I need to capture what it is that he told me. He said, come out and go to the land that I will show you. And it was not Bethel. So because it is not Bethel, and God has showed up here in Bethel, I will raise up an altar. And while I raise up an altar, I will worship God here, and I will give the place a name, Bethel. The word Bethel there is essentially the house of God. The house of God. The house of God. In other words, where God dwells, where God can live, where God can put up his presence is the word Bethel. Put up a tent. He stayed in Bethel for a period of time. God had encountered him by promise. He vowed by himself, I am going to give you this land. Remember, Abraham is sojourning. He stops in a place, and by spiritual intelligence, God speaks to him and tells him, now from here, mark it. From this place, this becomes the beacon. You are going to traverse east, west, south, and north. Whatever it is that you will step on, the seed that is going to come out of you is going to inherit that land. That information prompted Abraham to lift up and to raise up an altar. While he was on it, savoring the presence and the encounter, he moved again. The place of transition is not the place of permanence. And he removed thence, picked up his tent, and the family that he was with, went to the east of Bethel, the same place he was on the eastern side, pitched his tent there between high and on the east and Bethel on the west. And there he builds another altar. Notice, where he builds that second altar, God did not speak. God did not show up with an encounter. Now I'd like you to pay attention, believers. If you are waiting for the manifested presence of God for you to raise up your priesthood dimension, in other words, you want a spiritual encounter to jack you up to prayer, to jack you up to a spiritual experience, to maybe put faith in you. You're gonna wait for a long time, because not many saw often that God would come in the dimension of dramatic encounters. And if you're waiting for a dramatic move, oh, I saw as it were in the realm of the spirit, suddenly my window opened, suddenly an angel stepped in, suddenly I was taken to the street, and I was shown this and this, and that has galvan. You will wait for a long time, because in this case, the Lord did not appear. The Lord did not appear unto Abraham, yet he built himself an altar unto God. In other words, his priesthood had come of age to an extent that he knew, I have to have fellowship, and I have to put dominion on this territory. Up until then, the hour of the Chaldeans, the idolatry and the kind of worship that was going through the land that he was traversing, that land was already occupied. And please pay attention, because I've taught you this before. I have told you there is no vacuum in any territory, not in the realm of the spirit, not in the realm of men. Every territory has been taken care of. Every territory has an owner. Every territory has been taken. If you wait for an empty territory for you to go and occupy, you're going to wait again for a long time. Hear me? The scripture declared he built up an altar in someone else's territory, and he called upon the name of the Lord. That entire territory, Middle East, that entire hour of the Chaldeans, while he's walking out, traversing the promised land, going towards Canaan, was full of idolatry. It is the same land that the giants fell. It is from that same land that the progeny and the seed of the giants, spirits of fallen angels, traversed that same region. Yet here comes a man, and in priesthood, he begins to understand that I need to build altars. And for Abraham's lifespan, he built three altars. One in Bethel, one in Hebron, another one in Beersheba. And he built three altars. And after him came Isaac and came Jacob. And they were men of altars. Sir, I know you might love the Lord to that extent that you pray, but are you pitching your tent permanently in the place of yesterday's encounter? Because there are people who will have yesterday's testimony. Yes, they are the yesteryear God healed. 99, I remember this and this happened. This and that happened. And then from 2020, 2018, to when they're speaking that encounter or testimony, there is nothing. Nothing new. They have not grown in the faith. There is nothing to show for. There is nothing as a promise. You know the reason why? Because they picked the tent, pitched it on yesterday's encounter, stayed in Bethel, the place of encounter, yes, but they have not pitched their tent and built up a fresh altar. Yet, they have an encounter that was yesterday in Bethel. Notice he picked his tent, went to the east of where the first encounter was. So it is not enough to pray yesterday and have a breakthrough and clap hands and celebrate and disappear. No, you've got to perpetually put up sacrifices out of your prayer life, out of your priesthood daily, because you are pitching tents everywhere. You are securing the territory. Giants are in every land. In every man's land, there is a giant. In the realm of the spirit, there are giants everywhere. Dominion, thrones, powers, spiritual wickedness in high places. They don't work over, part-time. They work overtime. And they are secure territories for generations. And so Abraham, knowing that by spiritual intelligence, he begins to pick up the gauntlet, and he begins to lift up an altar again on the eastern side and the western side of Hai and Bethel. The God of yesterday was not enough for Abraham to encounter. The God of Bethel was not enough for him to encounter and move on in the power of that experience. As much as it was good, it is yesterday's revelation that creates today's religion. It is yesterday's revelation. Hear me. When the 70s came in the country here, Pentecostally speaking, the church up until then had traditional, that is in the East Africa, for those of you who are watching from abroad, up until the 70s, up until early 80s, the modern or the church then was using tambourines, African drums. I'm speaking East African experience. We're using drums, not electronic, but African drums and tambourine and kayambas and stuff. That was what the church was known for. And back in the 70s, there were no instruments, there were no lights, cameras and action. There was no big old screen like this one. There were no laptops, as it were, to that extent. They were still coming, but we were still in the dark side of worshiping God. And so in the 70s, 80s, early 80s, a man of God by the name Joe Kyle gets to preach, I think should be abroad or Britain, comes with an electric guitar. Back to Kenya, back in Africa, and he begins to orient the praise team or the music ministry and begins to electrify worship. Well, it is not the world that called the church the world. It is the church inside the church that began to call that man of God a devil worshiper, that his church is devil worshiping, that they're playing disco in church, and that people are worshiping the devil, that instruments are not supposed to be in the house of God. It is not holy. It is all that. You know why? What I've talked to you. Because they encountered God in the former move. The new move has just started, where God is trying to showcase excellence and to bring about a better sound and a new sound and to galvanize instrumentation. Because in the days of David, there were instrumentation. There was an entire 1,000 choir and instrumentalists and an entire orchestra in David's kingdom. And that was even before, that was way back in the BCs. That was way back in the ADs. And there were instrumentalists there. The instrumentalists were there, Asaph and his generation, David and his harp. And it is from the harpist chord that we get the piano. It is from the harpist chord that we get the piano. And now all of a sudden, here comes a church and here comes a people who have been stuck up in an old time religion. And now when a new move comes, they begin to persecute the new move. You know why? Because yesterday's move of God becomes today's religion. It's important for the church to know that as he built up an altar in Bethel, he moved from there, he plucked out of there, he went to another place, and he built an altar on the east side of Bethel, and on the other side there was Hai. He built another altar. He went again. He went to Beersheba. He built another altar. He went again into Hebron. He built another altar. The movements were of God. It is important for you not to build a monument out of an encounter with God, but rather to build a movement. Very important. And so here comes now to my first eye close. Jacob gets to be born out of Isaac. Isaac has run his race, and I'm paraphrasing here. He gets to the place where now he needs to hand over the mantle to his son. He calls Jacob, and he calls the other brother, and he lays the gauntlet unto them, and he tells them, go and make me such as I love, and food or soup or meat or venison, and bring it to me, and I will bless you. That instruction was given to Jacob, and the long story short of it, you know, he supplanted his brother. He got the blessing. That same Jacob, the trickster, he's now going and traversing the land like his forefathers. And I'd like you to pay attention to a very deep mystery here that begins to show up. A very deep mystery. Genesis 28 verse 16 to 17. And Jacob awaked out of his sleep, King James Version, and he said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I knew it not. Verse 17. And Jacob awoke out of his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I knew it not. And he named the place Bethel. Let me just look at my scripture. Genesis 28. He said, Verse 16, and Jacob awaked out of his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I knew it not. And then verse 17, and he was afraid and said, how dreadful is this place? This is none other but the house of God, one, and this is none other than the gate of heaven. Two things: the house of God, Bethel, and the gate of heaven. Now, this is Jacob, third generation out of Abraham the patriarch, and he is traversing in the same land, and out of the heritage that has been built up by his father, a man of prayer, a man of altars. I told you the other day, should be a Friday night, that Abraham was a prophet. The Bible declared, go unto Abraham Abimelech and return this man his wife, because he is a prophet. And because he is a prophet, he will pray for you. So priesthood is connected to the prophetic. I'll say that again. Priesthood is connected to the prophetic. And so he has passed on the behavior, the culture. He's passed on the mold and the, you would say, the curriculum of prayer to his generation. I'd like you to know that in the Jewish culture, patterns are very important. In the Jewish culture, behavior is very important, as it's connected to pattern and it's connected to culture. So you can't wake up one morning and go astray against the culture that has been mainstream in your father's house, because it has been handed down generationally. Especially when you get to bar mitzvah, when you get to the age of circumcision, when you get to transition to the place of becoming a man, you have been allocated a bunch of curricula that you may be able to know from your culture, that it is at 5 a.m. you do this, at 6 p.m. you do that, at certain festivals, this is what is supposed to be worn. They know it by culture. And so Abraham has passed the same thing to the children, or to Isaac, and Isaac has now passed it to Jacob. And now here comes what it is that we are dealing with in few minutes. Jacob is sleeping, coming off a journey. He takes two stones, places in his head, and he decides, let me get a rest as I head towards destiny. He's running, and here he comes an encounter. Suddenly, where he has slept becomes a place of encounter. So he is run to Bethel. Isaac has charged him, get off from here, and don't marry any other person outside the facility of our culture and our tribe. There, here comes again the behavior and the kind of teaching that the Jews, even up until today, have over their children. And he sends him away, sends Jacob away, Isaac now. And Esau, they have a little bit of tension, but Esau stays, and Jacob is sent out. And when he is on his journey, he gets tired and he lies down. Where he lies down there is a place towards Haran. He's in Beersheba. Jacob went out from Beersheba and he's going towards Haran. Notice again, three altars that his forefather had built before. Abraham is dead. Isaac is getting old. He's almost getting into to be connected with Abraham in terms of death. But here comes a third generation, a son that has no clue whatsoever what it is that he's about to get into. But by priesthood intelligence, he gets to rest in the very place that an altar was built years back without his knowledge. And so he lighted upon a certain place and he tarried there all night, verse 11 of Genesis 28, because the sun was set. He took the stones of that place and he put them for his pillow, and he lay down to sleep. And then all of a sudden, the experience shows up. Heavens get open, And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder is coming down. From the top of it is reaching heaven, and the angels of God are ascending and descending. Please note. Angels of God ascending and descending. I repeat that again. It's not a grammatical error in the Bible. The angels of God ascending, not descending from heaven. What activated the angels to come? What activated the spiritual experience for angels to come from down upwards and not upwards downwards? Priesthood did that. And I will prove it to you. And the Lord, behold, the Lord stood above it, said unto him, I am the Lord of covenant, the Lord of thy father Abraham, and the God of Isaac. The land whereon thou liest tonight, where it is that you've stayed here, I will give it unto thy seed. The same words he repeated on his grandfather Abraham, and he would not, and Jacob was not there, but he repeats the same promise. And then he says, to thy seed shall be like the dust of the earth. Thou shalt spread abroad on the west and on the east, the north, and thy seed, and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. While that encounter is happening, he gets to be given the marching orders, and he's told by promise, this is what is going to happen. I will give you this and this and that. I have read it to you. When he awakes, this is his remark. And Jacob awoke out of his sleep and said, surely not an angel, surely not a ladder, surely not the vision, surely not the encounter, the Lord himself is in this place, and I knew it not. Verse 7, and he was very afraid, because that is what encounters do. You come out of your senses, and you experience dimensions that are beyond the third dimension, the three tripartite dimension. And he was afraid, and he said, this is none other but the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. Tomorrow we'll be dealing with those two items, the house of God and the gate of heaven. And he rose up early. Now notice, here comes now the culture of raising up priesthood, raising up altars. This Bethel becomes the place of heritage. It becomes the place of a rich heritage of priesthood. And he says, verse 18, and Jacob rose up early. No one told him to rise up early. By culture, by initiation, watching his father Isaac, Isaac watching his father Abraham, he rose up early, took the stone which he had for pillows, set it up for an altar, and he poured oil on top of it, and then watched the name he called it. He called the name of that place Bethel. Genesis 12, where we've read, he built, Abraham built an altar at the place that was called what? Bethel. Isaac sojourning settles around the region. But Jacob, another generation, they have already moved. They're headed towards dominion and taking territory everywhere according to the word of the Lord. And Isaac, when God appeared to Isaac, he told him the same thing. This land I will give thee. And he comes to Jacob. He says to Jacob the same thing. This land I will give thee. And then now here comes. Jacob, by spiritual intelligence, by heritage, knows what to name the place. He knows how to name the place. He says this place surely should be the gate of heaven, the house of God and the gate of heaven. And the only thing to do here is to lift up an altar. He built up an altar out of the experience he had with God. And so if you move over to Nigeria in the West Africa region, they begin to name children after encounters. Should be something to do with a journey and coming back in peace. Should be something to do with the harvest that is bumper. Should be something to do with breaking the cycle of barrenness. And they will call the baby some long name. Ebenezer, something, something, something. You know what they are doing? they are connecting to the altar. They are connecting, they are raising up that boy, that child, that son, that baby, to be an expression of an experience they had with God in their own Bethel. Bethel, the place of encounter. Bethel, the place of priesthood heritage. Jacob knew by spiritual intelligence enough to know what it is to name the place. And he called the place Bethel. The name of that place was called Luz in the first place. It was called Luz, L-U-Z, Luz. But he called the place Bethel. It is in Bethel that Jacob is having an encounter, where another man by the name Abraham, grandfather, had labored to create an open heaven. The reason why he saw a ladder and he saw angels going up, not coming down, is because of the priesthood of Abraham that had taken over the territory. He had permeated altars of Abraham, had secured the territory. So a young man by the name Jacob would lie down, and he does not know that the stone he's lying on was part of the stone that built the altar that opened heaven. And so Bethel is open unto God and is open unto men, including Jacob, because it was a place of covenant. It was a place of covenant. What is it that you are building? I don't know what it is that you are building. But if you are building any spiritual legacy, be sure to know that if you litter altars by priesthood, if you can be able to begin to lift up altars in the realm of the spirit, priesthood becomes now the place where you will secure your generation, secure your children's generation, secure a third generation, secure the fifth generation, secure whatever generation by priesthood. Abraham had died, Isaac picked up the mantle. Isaac died, Jacob picked up the mantle. Jacob died, the rest of Joseph and the 12 princes that came out of him picked up the mantle. Up until today, you know the Jewish nation that is called Israel, because by heritage they handed over what? Priesthood to their generation. You will care to note that in the days when Abraham was blessing Isaac and the servants, he gave all the wealth that he had to the servants and to the people, and even to the slaves that he had bought, and even to the 389 army, mighty army that he had in his own house. He distributed unto Isaac. He called him, laid his hands on him, and gave him the blessing. What he was pushing and creating and putting into Isaac would not be equal to the wealth that he was distributing to the servants. What he was putting there was the purchasing power to be able to, rule thou in the midst of the enemy. In other words, wherever Isaac and his entire seed would go, they will have dominion. He was giving him the blueprint to making wealth. He was giving him the blueprint to having dominion. He was giving him the blueprint to having everything, including the lands of the seashore. He didn't give him money. As much as money is good and wealth is good to be given, most of you come from Africa. Most of you come from families. There is no heritage. There is not even an inheritance. You didn't even get a wheelbarrow. Didn't get even a bicycle. You're born out of poverty and lack and everything. There is nothing that has been put there to secure your future. You need to rise up to a next dimension, and by priesthood, secure unto your children Bethel. Secure unto your children Beersheba. Secure for your children Hebron. Secure unto your children the lands that were there. You need to know that when they were with Lot, Lot went for the green of Sodom and Gomorrah, just looking over the green land, and he decided, Abraham, you can go for the dry places. Let me go into the place where it is greener. Abraham had the promise. Lot did not have any promise. He was riding on the system and on the anointing and on the blessing. He was riding on the promise and the covenant that God had cut with Abraham. That is why he was prosperous. The day he cut off from Abraham, that was the end of Lot. It's important who you connect to. There are men and women that have cut a covenant with God, and if you connect with them, suddenly your life begins to have meaning. Suddenly your life begins to rise. Suddenly your life begins to have what it takes. You know, you begin to fly. And before, you are maybe moving in steps, one step after another. Suddenly speed comes to your direction. Very important. And so, we're going to finish now and get into another dimension. I'd like you to pay attention this week. Even as we come live to you, we are dealing with very, very deep things. I just laid a foundation somehow so that you can be able to know what it is that we are dealing with. We are not coming here just to dish cars and dish breakthroughs and dish weddings and dish cars and houses. No. We are securing an entire future, because the days that we are living in, the Bible declared, redeem the time, for the days are evil. And if there be any person out there watching tonight that needs this word, it will be you and your family. Priesthood intelligence, the gateway to prosecuting destiny. If Abraham would pray and he was in the dispensation of promise, sir, ma'am, you will have to pray more. Because you're in the dispensation of the kingdom of God. The Bible declared up until the prophets were, until John. From then on, men everywhere are pressing into the kingdom of God. For you to have dominion and for the cosmos and the marketplace to open. Maybe business, maybe marriage, maybe inheritance. Maybe for you to get into the place of wealth. That is the cosmos. It is in the dimension of men that people need money. It is the dimension of men that you need to marry. It is the dimension of the world system that you need to move from one place to another. You secure that by priesthood. Thank God for education. Thank God for enlightenment. But I can tell you, the all-time technology that Abraham, who is our example, and the Bible says, look unto Abraham, your father, and Sarah, your mama. I called them alone and blessed them. Look unto Abraham is the pattern man as to how to conduct priesthood and as to how to have dominion and as to how to take territory. Sir, it is that one family that owns the entire Middle East. That one family, the entire Middle East. Whether that will be from Saudi Arabia to Syria, to all the Middle East countries, it was given and handed over to one man. The title deed was with Abraham. One person conducted priesthood long enough with God, entered into dimension of promise with God, walked in obedience. He took an entire estate, the better part of the Middle East, to one man. God said, I vow that I will give thee. This came as a result of him sacrificing Isaac. He lifted up sacrifice, even of a human form, and picked Isaac. And when he was about to kill him, God said, now I know that Abraham, not only that you love me, but there is nothing I can hide from you. And then he says, because you have done this. In other words, you've gone to the place of high utmost sacrifice. High utmost priesthood. And I have taught you here before, there is nothing wrong with giving money to the kingdom of God. Nothing wrong with giving seeds, depending with what you want to connect to. But the highest dimension of sacrifice you can give is yourself. And you get that from Abraham. He picked his own Isaac. God came and said, take your son. And so that you don't confuse between Ishmael, pick your only son, Isaac. It was specific. It was clear. He picked Isaac, took him up the mountain. And he was ready to sacrifice him for God. For God. And God comes into the scene and tells him, now that you've done this, I give you the earth for an inheritance. What is it that you can touch by priesthood that God can vow your entire generation will never beg for bread? Your entire generation will never be poor. Your entire generation will never lack school fees. Your entire generation will build universities. God can vow, and by his own jealousy, guard your word and his word to you. And you will die and go, but your entire generation will be riding upon the kind of Bethel experience that you've had. Father, we thank you tonight. I would like you to open up your mouth and begin to pray now. Begin to pray now. In the name of Jesus. Tell the Lord, I have heard your word. Pray now. Open up your mouth. Tell the Lord what it is. Tell him. Tell him, I have heard thy word tonight. Yes, I want to be a patriarch in priesthood. I want to hand over into the next generation. Yes, not only a word, not only wealth, not only a house, but priesthood heritage, that by intelligence my generation can prosecute destiny cheaply. They can achieve cheaply. They can move with the God of Bethel cheaply. They can be able to subdue and have dominion cheaply. Open up your mouth and talk to God. Open up your mouth and talk to God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Maseke lebuhusha. Paruze de beha. Talika maska pratalia. Fahana mananomun. Delekasi vrahana kaskidia. Open up your mouth, Zion, wherever you are. Tell the Lord, tell the Lord, tell the Lord. I come standing in the need of prayer. Teach me to pray. Teach me to be a governor of the earth. To begin to communicate with heaven and the earth. To begin to legislate. And I will be teaching about legislation in the coming days. Legislation, legislation. He's put you here to legislate. He's put you here to legislate. He's put you here to legislate. He's put the church here to legislate. Not to have church. Not to have a good time. That's a byproduct. But to legislate. To legislate rather. To be able to put laws into manifestation and to practice the kingdom of God experientially on the earth. That territories will be able to hear God. That territories will be able to see God. In the name of Jesus. 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 Talk to God wherever you are. Lekosi paskele rebuhusha. Faridibi alakas kobrotolia kaina nanamanda. Zabado sekepretelia kaita lavana namanda. Leketekes kobrado saliga varadali. Zeketelebi inakantelia kama nanamusha. Mazude kepreteli kavana kasa. Retete sakantele kebredo sabia alakantele. Ziridibi alagabaso vratilia mananamusha. Meso pradalia kaita legemeno munda. Mizuza va anakabrasu pratalia kaita legemesa. In the name of Jesus. There's a little bit of volume. Aisamaka baruze bretosa ala kamano. Fahana kantelia kaita lebrosava hanama. Father, we ask tonight that Bethel will not only become an experience, that Father, you will give us intelligence enough for us not to get stuck with yesterday's anointing. Get comfortable with yesterday's breakthrough and begin to idolize the place instead of worshiping the God of the place, and begin to build up monuments around the thing that you've spoken unto us, around breakthroughs and things that we've prayed over time and you've answered, and now they've become idols in the hands of a believer, in the house of God, we begin to worship, you know, aesthetics and beauty and life in itself, and the breakthrough that you've brought unto us. We ask for an encounter, yes. We press in for an encounter, but we ask for a legacy. We ask for a legacy. We ask for a legacy. We ask for a legacy in the place of Bethel. We move to Beersheba. We move to Hebron. We move out of Bethel to Ai. We go lifting up, yes, by intelligence, prosecuting and subduing territories and putting our dominions and thrones under the subjection of the kingdom of God, that we may be able to know that we are not subjected to the place, but rather to the God of the place. We thank you, Father. We bless your name tonight. Some of you are watching out there tonight. have never had an encounter whatsoever with God. You love church, you go to church, but you also do clubbing. You go to church, but you also experiment with drinking. You go to church, you've never had an encounter, a personal encounter with God. You've never known His Son. You've heard about Him. You don't know Him. You've never had an experience with Him. I want to begin with you tonight. I want to pray with you. I want to pray with people that have never had an encounter with this God that we serve. It is one thing, ladies and gentlemen, to be in church all these years, even in the era of coronavirus, and have no experience with God. It's a dangerous place to be able to experiment with life with no insurance cover. Your insurance covering is salvation. It brings you into the kingdom, and you begin to enjoy the benefits of who God and what God is. He is not there to just cover you. He's not only there to take you to heaven. He's not only there to provide. He is the source. He wants a relationship with you. And so I want to pray with you tonight. For those of you who want to be born again, or you're a backslider, I'd like you to repeat this prayer after me tonight. Father, in the name of Jesus, I have heard your word. I am a sinner in need of a savior. You are the savior of the world. You are the son of the living God. I welcome you into my heart. Come live in me. Cleanse me from every sin that I have committed in the earth. I ask that your precious blood cleanses me from all sin. In Jesus' mighty name, write my name in the Lamb's book of life. Even right now, I receive thee. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. If you've prayed that prayer, you're born again. Backslider, come on back into the kingdom of God. Father, I commend them into the hands of God. The Holy Spirit, He that can be able to seal them with the seal of redemption until that perfect day when thou shall appear, and when we all shall appear before the throne of God. We ask in the name of Jesus, Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on your people tonight in the name of Jesus. They that you have given unto me, none of them shall be lost until the day of your appearing. We commend them into your hands. We decree and declare from now they are saved and born again in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Thank you, Father. Amen. The scripture declared, and angels will begin to celebrate even when one soul comes into the Lord. It's important to begin our broadcast in this fashion and in this studio with a call for salvation in the name of Jesus. We came here to touch lives and not have a good time and just show out. Or no, we came for souls. And in this era and age, many souls are gonna get born again from live television, from live broadcast, from social media, from posts. That is why I encourage you to use your social media effectively. So many have been healed because we came live. Many have received breakthroughs because we came live. So try think the kind of multiplier effect we can have if you begin to speak things that we speak here and share them on your social media. If you're here for the first time and this is your first time, I'm Prophet John Haggai and I welcome you. We come every other week, and I'd like you to do this. Do me a favor. The YouTube channel link is going to go up in a moment, and I'd like you to go and subscribe there if you've not subscribed to our YouTube channel. John Haggai Ministries YouTube channel is going to be coming up shortly. And while it is coming up, if you have not subscribed to our channel, we are about to get into 1,000, very few remaining, so that we can come live. There are people waiting very anxiously on YouTube so that we can go live. And I like you and encourage you, when you are bringing a person that you've tagged into a live broadcast, ask them if they have gone or if they have subscribed to our YouTube channel and link them there. You can copy paste it and tag it to them. You can encourage them to go there and just click subscribe and let us build the numbers. Let us build the numbers. In the name of Jesus. Glory to God. Well, is that other time again? We wanna. You will excuse me if you keep seeing me looking down. I'm looking at the gadget and I'm looking at your names. And then we're gonna come back. This is a studio format. And it will happen over and over, but eventually we are going to get used to looking through and to looking at you. But it surely feels closer to be there. And I like to put an announcement also before I forget. My tech people advised that we will have to put this announcement to you. We are going to get into Zoom conferences or conferencing, if you may. And I would like to put an announcement to you that if you don't have a good quality smartphone, believe God for one that can take the application for Zoom. Because we'll be doing prophecy now and teachings and have even closed session that can be subscribed to. It will be by subscription that we can be able to teach certain things. It will not be in public every time so that joyriders cannot just come. And you've paid the price to be here all over the year, and 1 year, some of you 2 years, some of you 3 years, and someone just comes and joyrides and gets something tangible. There will be that. There will be the plenary, and there will be closed sessions and closed classes where we can be able to deal with very deep things of the kingdom. And you will do well if you get a smartphone that can be able to take the Zoom application, and it is going to be very, very key during this coming of days. So I'll put that announcement out for you again, that we will be coming live to you. We will announce it to you, and the passwords will be there. The links will be done. It will be timed so that when we begin to come, even during the day and even during the night and even pre-recordings of other live sessions, so that we can be able to deal with a live session that is a class and other sessions that are going on throughout the page and throughout YouTube, so that we can build up people in the Word of God. Sir, Scripture declared that in the last days, which we are in, the Word of God will be rare. It will be rare. It will be very, very expensive to access, because then truth that is expendable. I'll say that again. Truth that is expendable. Truth that is expendable is cheap to acquire. It's cheap to access. Truth that is not expendable has to be searched out. It is the glory of God to reveal a thing and hide it in His glory. And then it takes the glory of kings, or the honor of kings, which you and I are, to search out that which God has hidden in His glory. And so the technology is here, it is available. You will be noticing a lot of things changing in regards to our approach to ministry and in regards to that. So if you're here and you would really want to be in Zoom meetings, there will be all that. The forms will be there. Some of it will be on Facebook. Some of it will be registration, an online form that will come. The passwords will be sent to you. Open forums, the passwords will be open. Closed forums, the passwords will just come either to your WhatsApp or to the WhatsApp group that is going to be formed as it regards this community. So please pay attention, because that is where we are headed. That's where we are headed. Jesus said something the other day. He said it is very, very important that you do not throw pearls to pigs, and that pearls that are precious metals, you serve or you keep them for the purpose that they are, because they are precious. And he said something the other day also. Jesus said unto the woman, the woman came and said, even the dogs take crumbs from the table of the master. He said then, bread is given to the children of the house. So we are going to serve you bread, the hallowed bread, in the house. And the house is not Facebook. The house is the ministry. Just that the platform is called Facebook. Pounds will not be given through Facebook. We have done that for the better part of 3 years, and we have seen that it has a quality deficiency somehow. But when you begin to build up a community and begin to pour in into people, people begin to be built up. Okay? Yes, and it will cut off also what I call a spiritual prostitution. There is a lot of it in the kingdom of God. People moving from just collecting jewels and collecting pearls and collecting precious spiritual metals from men and women of God. They do not honor them. They don't honor their anointing. They don't honor their office. They can't pay the price. Yes, so very key. It's important for the church to know that after we are going and we are putting this up as a preamble, because we are headed towards television online, we are headed towards radio online, we are headed towards big things that the Lord has commissioned and has asked us to do. So it's very important for you to hang in with us, and I know all of you are really committed people. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to thee. Sharon Otieno, I don't know if you are there. Spirit of the Lord is telling me to tell you, I think I wrote to you something. Lady Sharon Otieno, I'm not going to read all of your mail, but I will tell you this. I'd like you to watch the month that is called April, the fourth month of the year 2021. The Spirit of the Lord is telling me clearly to tell you that He is sending help to your direction from another quarter. He is sending help to your direction from another quarter. I hear it again. He is sending help to you, Sharon, from another quarter. I don't know what that means, but it could be that whatsoever it is that you've been relying on, God is getting ready to bring unto you a different direction altogether. And that is a word of wisdom for you to know that God is speaking to you, Lady Sharon. Someone is gonna pay for your ticket. I see someone that is gonna pay for your ticket. So that tells you that the Lord has opened that door. I see someone, and it is not relative. You are not connected unto them in terms of blood. Omnipotent Father. That's what I hear to tell you, Sharon. Like you to pray. I like you to take time, separate yourself, get off the schedule, get off social media sometime, get off social media, get off, shut yourself into prayer. If you'll take a journey, take a journey. If you don't, if you have to stay where you stay, but separate yourself and take time to pray. The Spirit of the Lord is telling me He will show you something in your dream not so many days from now. And that dream is going to be directional. Welcome in this place, omnipotent Father of mercy and grace. Power will come in this place. Lakaso para sebrenele. Vanana moshe de bedo sabradale. Malakas kobrotolia kaida de bohusha lama. Azinta lekeveno no mosa liakaita levara. Saikete telia gabazo brotoska bratelli kamana na munda. Thank you, Father. Lady Rita Wairimu there. Lady Rita, I'm going to come to you in a moment, Wairimu. I want you to be praying. Lady Rita Wairimu, be praying now. Be praying. The lady from Mexico. The lady from Mexico. I don't know if your interpreter is there with you. I don't know if your interpreter is there with you. Malia Selevenu Mohoshe Minakare Saikata Tali Baroza Frantali Kamano Sapai. Thank you, Father. Blessed be thy holy name. Patricia, are you there with the you are there? I can see you. I can see you. I can see you. I have a word for your pastor, Patricia. I had a word for your man and woman of God today. I like you to get a notebook or if you can, whatever it is that you can, just write it down. He's telling me to tell them, the man and the woman of God, that there will be no premature death in their family. That is number one. I saw something in the realm of the spirit when you sent me their picture. And the Lord had spoken unto me to say, to cancel an assignment of the enemy that regards two things. Premature death and a host of family members that are tied into the word is called mob. They use it in the drug world. Victims of mob and victims of injustices. This should be either the woman of God, or the man of God from their family line. And number three, that they are not in danger, that the angel of the Lord has been activated over them, especially in a certain region that is full of the influence of the mob that runs around about, and you and I know what it is. You might not know that history, but I'm giving you the word because you are connected to them, and you can send it to them or interpret to them in the lingua that they understand. Lady Aima Perez, God is giving you long life. He is adding to your life. He is adding to your life. And COVID will not touch you. COVID will not touch you. COVID will not touch you. Ambrose, would you come? Glory to God. Masakia lamana sovradose. Vahana kazebridili ina kamano no moshai. Melt me. Hold me. Feel me. Use me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Hallelujah. Some volume. Pasikabas elebrezofra anakadash. Lekosi ama anamanosa brantelia vananamosha. Thank you, Father. Sharon Otieno, again, I don't know why is it, I think you've prayed today or something. But the Spirit of the Lord is telling me to tell you about your sister. Because I mentioned at the other time a number of counties. But there is an isolation, I see the Spirit. And she should begin to apply by faith there. Migori. Migori is where the Spirit of God is highlighted. Migori. Migori. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on. Hallelujah, glory to God. Fall afresh on me. Fall afresh on me. Fall afresh on me. Kaita lo sedemena. Fararauze lia kaina na namase levrentolo. Bazuze hes kapaiti lia kaina mana. Bazuza bate kebrentali kavana no munde le deves kapratali. Sade de behosha ina kabra sovrahana. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. I don't know if there is anyone that is not feeling well out here now, currently. You actually came to the service and your body is refusing really to move. Somehow you've been battered throughout the week with a very heavy flu-like symptom, and it's nothing to do with COVID, but you're battered with either high temperature and headache. High temperature and headache. Lady Rita, while I'm speaking that out, I call out of the inside of you anything that has been hidden as a gift. As a matter of fact, Lady Rita K.Y.Remo, the Spirit of the Lord is telling me that it has been a while that you've neglected your gift. Spirit of the Lord is telling me, Rita, that God has anointed your mouth. It's nothing to do with only selling. It's not just about selling. It's not just about creating things to sell. But it is also about speech. Speaking around the word of, around your family, community. And it's showing me that you have a lot of influence. A lot of influence in your family. If you begin to share with them the word of God, many of them are going to be saved by watching your life. Many of them are going to be saved by watching your life. And many people here watching tonight, your relatives are watching and looking at you and looking at your life. There is a result that can shut the mockery, but yet also there is a faith and a dimension of Christian life that can attract people unto God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Patricia, tell the man of God, God is about to take them. Let me ask you, Patricia, I hear a name. Something to do with chapels, not El Chapo. Something to do with a place that ends with a chapels. I am really trying to pronounce that name. Yes, Lord. Maike sila mana sovratalia. There is a land that is about to be acquired in that ministry for expansion for the man and woman of God from Mexico in lieu of a community leader. Anna, it is you I am talking about. Terrible flu. I rebuke it out in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I'm looking through your comments here, and that is how I can be able to function so that I know you are responding. In the name of Jesus, be healed, be set free. Mali Sakabas Oma. Kazidia Bararoske Pratale. Patricia. Patricia, hear the word of the Lord. There is something connected. There is something connected. There in Mexico where the church is. Something connected to this man and woman of God. To a name. Guadalupe. Guadalupe. Either it is an offshoot of where they came out to be born again from, or is a city. Those two things. And I will need clarity from you if you know. I just had the name Guadalupe. Guadalupe, if I am pronouncing it correctly. God is about to expand that church in the coming days. In the coming days. Just record this word and give them and let them interview them. And then you can bring back. And bring back the word of God. The confirmation. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Blessed be thy holy name. Blessed be thy holy name. Blessed be thy holy name. Ina Banadine, Ina, where are you watching from, Lady Ina? Ina Banadine, where are you watching from? Quickly. Masa teleberurubo shalevana. Brenta kizalia kaipere sobra dale ferenomusha. Rita, you need to speak much. I don't know why is it that something connecting to your silence has aggravated a condition around your life. Rita K. Wairimo, you need to begin to speak. The scripture declared in Proverbs 18, should be 21, 22. Death and life is in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Lady J. Lucas, the instruction is very simple from the Lord regarding that entire matter. Not only is he going to protect you from any harm, but he's going to shut down the mouth of lions that are around you. People who want to devour your future and your character. God is speaking to me to tell you, Lady Lucas, Jay, that in the coming year you should be ready. He's getting ready to settle and beautify your life once again. It will not be long, but he's telling me to tell you not to mix up your spiritual activity with any form of tradition, any form of traditional values or traditional, what you will say, practice down there in South Africa. He's warning me to tell you that if you can pray, separate yourself, serve God like the Spirit of the Lord told you that last week, he's getting ready to lay a table in the presence of your enemies, and he will get the glory. He's telling me to tell you, forgive and let go. A fresh start is coming. A fresh start is coming. Your face burns to me. I asked a question for someone there. Where are they watching from? I don't know if they have answered. There's a lady called Suzanne there, Waffler. Suzanne, where are you watching from also? Like nothing ever seen, who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Bob, I don't know where Lady Lucy is today. Is Lady Lucy here? Bob? You are beautiful beyond description. Majesty enthroned above. And I stand in awe of you. I think that apart from Anastasia, there is someone else that came with sickness here. The Spirit of the Lord is showing me is something to do with your belly, something to do with abdominal something, pain. Yeah, check it now. It is gone in the name of Jesus. Lady Lucy, you are here. Good to see you. I stand in awe of you, Holy God, to whom praise is due. Stand in awe of you. Mazagi Beresko Bradale. Baraza, you say it is your wife who has abdominal pain. That's what I'm talking about. Because I saw a woman, apart from Anna, saying she came into the service sick. I stretch my hands in the name of Jesus. She can touch your phone. She can touch her phone. Now, in the name of Jesus, heal the power of the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Father. Makoseke pretele. Gideon, Gigi, in the name of Jesus, I kill the parasite. I kill it out of your stomach now, in the name of Jesus. You two, be made whole. Be made whole. Be made whole. In the name of Jesus. Suzanne, my instruction to you is very simple. You need to settle in a spiritual house. Waffler Suzanne, you need a spiritual covering that will watch over your life spiritually. I see, but in the realm of the spirit, somehow, one way or another, that you've not been in one church only. In other words, there is something that necessitated your movement. Spirit of the Lord is telling me to tell you, settle down. There is a blessing that a man of God needs to release and watch over you. And it will come to pass that if you do this, you will notice that your spiritual life will take a dive in the spirit. In other words, not take a dive downwards, but upwards. It will sky up. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Blessed be thy holy name. Blessed be thy holy name. We are about signing out now. We're not going to take time as we usually do tonight. We will set it up for another time where we can have this. But we are getting ready to sign up. I'm going to speak to three other people. And while I am doing that, there's a lady called Phyllis Rua Kamau. I am looking for you. Nazaria Teselevana. For all of you here and everyone that is new here, I'd like you to pay attention that we don't come live into this service to prophesy. We come into the live service to speak the word of God, one, to fellowship with the Spirit of God, two, And then the byproduct of that is the Spirit of God will release impartations and it will speak to your cases. We don't just come as a prophetic service and as a prophetic ministry to come and dish out our prophecies. No, we are not doing that. It has a multiplier effect into making people numb to the Word of God and just come curious to watch and to hear our prophecy. I don't do that personally, and that's why I teach fast and put a platform and a foundation of the Word of God, and then the voice of God will come to speak to the things that He needs to speak, not to the things you want Him to speak to, not to the things you brought into the service, no. He will speak to the thing that is priority in the realm of the Spirit concerning you. That He will. And He will speak clearly. Suzanne Wafla, you are saying, I've been sharing this with my sister about your church situation. Thank you for insistence. There you have it. That is the word of wisdom. By direction, God wants you to settle. And as a matter of fact, there is a church that you are close to where you live. It is called Deliverance Church. It is in Umoja. It is pastored by Bishop J. Masinde. Go there. You will be fed there the word of God holistically. Yeah, that is prophecy too. It's not just because I know JB, Bishop, or because I know Deliverance Church Umoja. I just heard that right now for you. Settle down. Settle down. And if you want to follow this ministry, you can follow this ministry over and over. It's an interdenominational ministry. You can go to your service and come to this service. Yes, sir. You need to be discipled, male. Phyllis Rua Kamau, if I'm pronouncing your name correctly, I'd like you to prepare. Because I see a journey coming, not so long from now. A journey, in other words, not just one journey in terms of going physically, but also a spiritual journey. It seems to me in the spirit that there is something that will demand your spiritual maturity in the coming days. It could be something to do with either your marriage or something to do with relocation that will demand your spiritual maturity. This only can be only gotten and found in the place of prayer. That is the direction I will tell you. Maike se bredo savrana lamando. Vadadabaso bradalia. Meritindo, you are telling me that the lady I've spoken about up there, Suzanne, is your sister. And you talked about joining Deliverance Church Umoja to her. That is the Spirit of God right there then. So the lady Suzanne, you have your confirmation. I was not there when your sister was talking. The Spirit of the Lord has just told me to tell you that. I'd like you to pay attention in the coming week. Be here every night. We will be here one way or another. As we are setting up the studio fully, we will still continue with the conference, and I'll speak to each and every one of you according to the Spirit of God as He speaks to me by prophecy. While I am picking up the second person and the third one and we finish, I'd like you to get your offering for the night. Get your offering, get to your phone, get to whatever thing that you want to do, you need to use to give, and let us honor God in the name of Jesus. 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 Get your offering out. Let us worship God as I call the second person that I heard in the name, in the spirit to call. We're going to sign out. I'd like you to invite as many as possible and be patient. We will prophesy until tomorrow morning. The spirit and the gift and the office is there. It's not exhaustible. Whatever urgent situation that it is that you have, maybe tomorrow, maybe Tuesday, I sense and I just heard in the spirit there are people here that are under pressure to do something big between tomorrow and Sunday. I call it out in the name of Jesus. Helpers are coming to your direction. By the Spirit of grace, I release angelic ministry and help to your direction. It doesn't matter what cutthroat pressure is on you. It doesn't matter what timeline. It doesn't matter how fast that time is going. God is above time. I speak to you in the name of Jesus. You and your entire house, you and your business, you and your endeavors, whatever it is, whatsoever is giving you pressure, even now, maybe in secret, maybe in private, you've not shared it with anyone. I speak to you as a man of God, and I decree and declare, help is coming. Help has been released to you now. In the name of Jesus, you will testify. You will testify. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Last but not least, let me pick someone here. And then we sign out, we go. I am meeting you tomorrow as we pick up day two of this conference. In the name of Jesus. Alatose presevrana cabrodella. Salia manana moshala bradaza vrena cascalia. Sidinibi alavrano sevrantelia. Kaininimi aze. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Get your sacrifice out. Get your seed out. Lady Bartha, I don't know why again this comes over to you. The Spirit of the Lord suddenly will take me to the village. And this is now something very interesting. Because what I see is an ancient door that many people have aligned, and I'm speaking spiritual language here, trying to get through that door, and all of them died. All of them. Not even one of them could go through that door to the next dimension of life. The Spirit I hear now to say, and I've spoken with you this before, He is canceling premature death. And is shutting down every demonic networking that wants to take someone in the family this year. Someone in the family very close to you this year. Hear the word of the Lord, Lady Bartha. I want you to call your sister today. Yeah. The one and only. The lady, the mom to Gigi. I want you to call her tonight, if you can, whatever time zone space you will find. I don't know how it will sound to them, but there is a divine instruction. And I think I'll end with you. It's a divine instruction. There is something hanging in the balance. That is all you will say. And if they need clarity, they can talk to me on WhatsApp. But I sense and I see in the Spirit, there is something hanging in the balance regarding a position that she's sitting on. That is one. And two, something to do with our health. The Spirit of the Lord is sounding a warning and is bringing not only hope but direction to her. You see, that is the reason why it is very good to have one sister born again and filled with the Spirit of God and mature like you are. Tell her the prophet said, there is an urgency in the Spirit. There is an urgency in the Spirit. There is an urgency in the Spirit. Malise levrasemani alamana soba ai elamakose predele. Vahana kaselia ante manonza. Vi ikasi ibrozoli ala kabraskota takai. Kididibi alamana no munde lege fresco pai. Saka telekemeno no moshali inagandele. Fani ni mi ante sebe sakai ki apaso fahana kasubra teli akai ni mi avo. In the name of Jesus. Bartha, not only you, that long life is your portion. Gigi, Robert, and the other siblings. But I see in the spirit an uncle back there. It's not someone we've spoken about. The Spirit of the Lord is going to save them. They are going to be born again this very year. Yes, I see someone that really loves to wear shorts, not trousers, shorts. Shorts is an anchor to Gigi and Robert, but he's your brother. I'm talking to Bartha now. The hand of God is gonna touch this gentleman not many days hence, because God wants to heal, and it is that healing that will draw him close. He's gonna get out of all that infrastructure that has been around Legio Maria and marine and divination and stuff like that. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. I'll finish with Jonathan now. Lady Lucy, Jonathan, and Brian. Spirit of the Lord is telling me to tell you, especially for you, Jonathan. He's telling me to tell you, a few months from now, especially in the coursework that you're doing, something is going to come that is supernatural to you in terms of your memory. I don't know if this is quantum, something physics, but there is a very difficult subject you are struggling with, and it has to point towards the GPA in your graduation. Hear the word of the Lord. He said the memory of the just is as a shining light. Now, the path of the just is as a shining light. And that the memory of the righteous or of the just is blessed. The memory of the just is blessed. I'd like you to lay your hands wherever you are now. Lay your hands, even if I think I called Brian. I don't know if it's Brian, your other brother. I'm in a different realm, so names keep on coming and flashing. And I could be calling a stranger, but I think it's Brian. Hear the word of the Lord. Lay your hands on your brain. There is a difficult exam you're about to sit. I don't know if it is connected to anything quantum, but God is going to supernaturally put memory into your system as you read. Hardware, in terms of your mind, that is. And you're going to ace that exam that will count on your GPA. And not many days hence, there will be a scholarship that will be released out of that, even as you graduate. Because it is pointing towards that. All people and in terms of departments and universities will be looking at the GPA, but based on that course. Now take that anointing in the name of Jesus, and may God make it to be you and your brother in the name of Jesus. And to the twins in the name of Jesus, Lady Lucy, let it be so too, in the name of Jesus. I hear in the spirit, Lady Lucy, to tell you, I don't know if this is an American system or it should be something to do with an SEE or SAT exams, SAT something, SAT, that is what I see, the initials I see. It could be cheap, it could be easy. But it could be technical. The Spirit of the Lord is telling me in the days to come, when they will be looking even into SAT examination, they will ace it. And scholarship will be released. Scholarship will be released. Scholarship will be released. In the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. I will leave it there for tonight. We are meeting Monday. please pay attention. Father, we thank you for tonight. We bless your name. I stretch my hands to you now. May the Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face to shine upon you. Be gracious unto you throughout this week. Let there be good news coming out of your phones. Let there be testimonies. Collide with possibilities. This week, may the hand of God be upon you. May your bread and your water be blessed. Let there be provision for your vision. In the name of Jesus, we decree and declare this year that many of you will drive cars that you never thought you will buy. Many of you will move houses you never thought you will live in. Many of you will acquire things by the blessing of God that maketh rich and addeth no sorrow. We decree speed to your direction. Collide with good news this week. May the hand of God be upon you, you and your family. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen and amen and amen and amen. Well, I've been your host, Prophet John Haggai, say, if it is not God we serve, then we serve nothing at all. Until I see you tomorrow, by the grace of God, stick it out here with us. Give us one ear as we've always promised you. See where God will take you, even through this prophetic ministry. We love you to life. Until we see you again. Bye-bye. Amen.